So let's go over screen benefits, though, because the truth is, I just did, it was really actually a very cool thing. So in my addiction studies class, I assigned my students to read a book called The Dark Net by Jamie Bartlett. Has anybody read this book yet? It's super awesome. I recommend it. It's called The Dark Net by Jamie Bartlett. And I'll tell you what happened. So the head of my department is very kind to me. He lets me kind of do what I want because I've been there forever. I'm like a grandma on staff. And I said, I want to assign this book, even though it doesn't have much to do with addiction studies. He said, I trust you. Go ahead and do it. So I assigned it to my students. And the reason why is because has anybody ever heard of The Dark Net? Does anybody know what it is? Okay, it's pretty strange, I'll tell you. So the dark net is an underground internet. You go through on a special browser called a Tor browser, and if you go through that browser, your signal bounces from computer to computer, and it's encrypted and re-encrypted and re-encrypted, so you're not traceable. So when you're on the dark net, you're anonymous. And the 50,000 websites on the dark net are also pretty much anonymous, except by the FBI on occasion when they're after somebody. So I had them read it because this is where a lot of action is going down on this dark net, and it's really an interesting philosophical experiment about how people behave when they're not being observed. And you can imagine how that is. You see a lot of bad behavior on the dark net. You see the Silk Road, which is a commerce site for drugs, and a very effective one. The founder of the Silk Road was prosecuted and is spending life in prison, and within 2 months of him being prosecuted, another one was up. Actually, within 2 weeks, it was up and going. So you can't stop it. It's going. A lot of child pornography, a lot of amateur pornography. You can hire a hitman. You can hire a hacker. There's trolls, which are people who, you know, argue and get pretty vicious online. There's a lot going on there. So what I assigned is, I want you guys to read The Dark Net and take a position if you're a tech optimist or a tech pessimist. Do you think we're going in the right direction and we should go full cyborg? Or do you think we're going in the wrong direction and we should go back to our log cabins? And we had a debate. The cool thing, the reason I'm even telling you this, and I'm off topic, welcome to my lecture style, is that I wrote the author and I said, love your book, we're using it in class, and he said, I would love to Skype in for more than. And he did. He has a TED Talk, he's done the circuit, he Skyped in to our class for an hour, and the students, I surprised him, and they completely nerded and geeked out. It was the coolest thing. Someone came up and said, this is my favorite educational experience I've had so far. We recorded it, and I just put it on my website today. So if you go to getkidsinternetsafe.com/blog, I have an hour video of Jamie talking about what it was like to interview all the players on the dark net, all the challenges of that, and what he thought about it now that he's on the other side. It's really interesting. So back to benefits. Okay, so speaking of benefits, clearly, you guys can't see that, it's not bright enough probably, is it's an incredible learning tool. It's an incredible learning tool. It's effective, ecological, and economical, right? It's cheap. It gives us enormous access to information, and it allows us to learn skills. You know, if my fridge breaks, I no longer have to call a repairman out. I can look it up, and it kind of tells you what to order and how to do it. It really expands our potential as learning humans. Some other benefits include communication, right? Access. I mean, we have better access to each other than we've ever had. Clarity, immediacy, and dissemination. We can store a lot on our computers now. We don't have to have, you know, big, huge bookshelves full of books and photo albums. It's all right there in our hands. And it also allows us to track. It's a safety tracker. We know where our kids are, we know what they're doing, and we can communicate with them. Most of all, it's a big source of entertainment. Most of us spend a lot of time playing.
Show me. you name it, you've been told.
Going through a withdrawal syndrome like you see with drugs and alcohol. with internet, although it's not in our most recent diagnostic manual, it's listed as a topic for further study. And it's a behavioral addiction, much like addiction, like gambling or sex addiction or shopping. And we're starting to see inpatient facilities crop up to treat it, just like we've seen in Asia in large numbers. We also see screen media risk as a destructive digital footprint, their online reputation, and an unhealthy self-body image. So I have interns at the university who help me with Get Kids Internet Safe, and some of them pick body shame as their topic of interest. And it's because nudity is so prevalent on the internet now that it's changing the way children view sexuality and themselves. And even print media now, you know, with digital enhancement, the models often are one person's eyes, somebody else's nose, somebody else's chin, and everything's altered from there. So they're not even real human beings. I mean, they can't even pick a model that's beautiful enough to tolerate our appetites anymore. Celebrities don't help. Other health risks include multitasking. Now, this is a particular interest to me, and what we know about multi-kids, my daughter's best friend, Jackie, isn't she cute? She looks like a professional model. And the truth is, most of us do multitask. My university students absolutely do, and the kids and teens will if you allow it. And the problem with multitasking is our brains aren't built that way. There's no such thing. It's a myth. What you're doing is you're toggling between different tasks very quickly. And actually, the more you multitask, the better you get at it. But you don't recognize the response cost. In other words, your performance declines. So if I put you guys all through an experiment where, you know, you're working on something and you're getting pings from your text and you're going back and forth, and I gave you a survey and said, how much do you think the texting interfered with your performance? Overwhelmingly, you would say it didn't. I did fine. But the research is clear across the board that, in fact, it does affect performance up to 20%. That's a letter grade. So the problem is we don't recognize that it's affecting our performance. We're unable to identify that. And then the other is too much access and overuse and addiction. Right? I mean, it's rare I go to a concert where not everybody's not watching it through their phone. It's just changed. So here's one thing.
Why our kids struggle not to overuse screen media. Did you know that the prefrontal region of the brain, the part that involves impulsivity, conflict reasoning, and problem solving, doesn't fully mature until we are 23 years old? This is why kids don't recognize future consequences and make unwise decisions. Did you also know that screen media may lead to excessive dopamine in the pleasure center of the brain in a similar way that all drugs of addiction do? That means some kids drift into pre-addiction behavior patterns, like flow, when video gaming or using social media. Although every child's different, boys tend to prefer gaming and girls tend to prefer social media. Surging dopamine in the pleasure center quickly overpowers an immature frontal lobe. That means our kids need us to guide them well into what we consider adulthood.
So, you know, the question
when
really
it's your
is,
kids on the line, go.
The question really is, can we trust our kids to do this on their own? And I would say no, they don't have the wiring. It. We're going to need to step in more than we do. Oops, I'm going backwards. All right. Now, in regard to exploitation for profit, and this is all the scary part. I get to answer soon. Don't worry. So, violence, pornography is something that is an absolute risk. I wrote all about video games.